are in fifth grade or younger, Kathy Dustman is there for Kids Church. If you are interested in going, otherwise, you're welcome to stay. Well, good morning, everybody. What a very, very beautiful day to be gathered in this place, praising God, worshiping God, and learning more about Him together. So this morning, we will be taking a look at the first four verses in chapter 10 in the book of Romans. And when the weeks of our series were originally mapped out, I had a much longer section of verses planned for today, but I quickly realized that just wasn't going to be possible. Because packed in just four verses, Paul shows us some really important things. And that is how the gospel message affects, at least how the gospel message should affect, the way that we view those who do not yet know Jesus as their Savior. And that isn't something that we can just highlight, right? This is foundational. It's something that we need to treasure, something we need to understand, and something that we need to put into practice. So before we go any further, let's pray. Lord Jesus, we come before you this morning, and you have ordained this day before our feet touched this planet. You knew what this day would hold, and so, Lord, we just surrender it into your hands. You are the only one who can do your work, and so we just pray that you would move mightily in this place, that the Holy Spirit would do what only the Holy Spirit can do, that the words spoken would be your words for your kingdom, for your people, for this day. In Jesus' name, amen. So this week, Paul is very specific about his personal desire for the Israelites. And he's not speaking matter-of-factly about them. He speaks from his heart, how he feels personally about their spiritual condition. So let's take a look at Romans 10, 1 through 4. Brothers and sisters, my heart's desire and prayer to God for the Israelites is that they may be saved. For I can testify about them that they are zealous for God, but their zeal is not based on knowledge. Since they did not know the righteousness of God and sought to establish their own, they did not submit to God's righteousness. Christ is the culmination of the law, so that there may be righteousness for everyone who believes. So Paul opens this section of text making the desire of his heart clear. And then he follows it up with three specific reasons for why he feels the way that he does. His heart's desire is that the Israelites may know Jesus Christ. And he's praying for their salvation because he knows they're not yet there. They are not saved based on the three things that he shares. He says they're zealous for God, but their zeal isn't based on personal knowledge of God. And they don't know God's righteousness. They've tried to establish their own righteousness. Therefore, they can't submit to God's righteousness. And then the last thing he says is Jesus' coming was the end of the law. And if they're basing their salvation on the law, well, the law doesn't save a person. And there is a direct connection from the last paragraph of chapter 9 to the first paragraph of chapter 10. And the last paragraph in chapter 9 was all about the gospel, specifically how we are to view Christ in relation to sin and into righteousness. So in verse 4, when Paul says Christ is the end of the law so that salvation is for everyone, he's taking us back to that final point. So we're going to take a quick look at those verses again. Romans 9, verses 30 through 33. He says, "What shall we say? That the Gentiles who did not pursue righteousness have obtained it, a righteousness that is by faith. But the people of Israel who pursued the law as a way of righteousness have not attained their goal. Why not? Because they pursued it not by faith, but as if it were by works. They stumbled over the stumbling stone. As it is written, 'See, I lay a stone in Zion that causes people to stumble, and a rock that makes them fall, and the one who believes in him will never be put to shame.'" Paul is saying that the Gentiles who believe in the gospel message of Jesus Christ, they have obtained God's righteousness because they pursued it the right way. They pursued it by faith. But the Israelites, they have not even achieved their own goal of receiving God's righteousness because they didn't pursue it by faith. They pursued it by their self-righteousness instead. And as long as anyone seeks to acquire salvation by doing things like the Israelites did, the grace of Jesus is going to be a stumbling stone. Because Jesus, he can only be one of two things. He will either be the stone that we trip over because of our self-righteousness, or he will be the rock that we build our lives upon because of his righteousness. So this past week, my family was blessed to be able to enjoy some time away in Door County. And this is a trip that we've made for the past 5 years. We absolutely love it. We look forward to it. This year, we found a really cool park that we had never heard of before where you can do some cliff jumping. And Kate's going to pop a picture up. That is my son Hunter jumping off. Leah is in the background, and she's anticipating her jump. And you can see from Chris's face, he's contemplating his jump. Aubrey jumped as well, and, you know, even this old gal took the plunge once. I put them up there because they're a lot cuter. So what you cannot really see, though, however, is that the distance between the water and the rock is 14 feet, and that is a lot. And what you also cannot see is that when you jump in, you obviously have to jump out. And the way that you have to jump out is around the bend of those rocks. And in theory, it's easy breezy to get out. There are these beautifully, I guess nature made them, stairs that you could just like hop out of the water. In theory, it sounds like a graceful exit. But as I stood on that cliff, contemplating this life choice that I was making, Hunter was gracious enough to jump in first and wait for me in the water. And as I continued to stand on that cliff, contemplating the choice that I was making, a really cute couple jumped in the water, and they also waited. And they cheered me along with this crowd that gathered on the cliff's edge. So no pressure. And as I stepped off the rock, I instantly realized there's no going back, right? That is such an odd reality to face when you are in the middle of the air. But what I could not have realized as I plunged into the water was the challenge that lay ahead of me just around the bend. Hunter swam ahead of me, and we went around the cliff, and as we went around the cliff, I was struck with wave after wave just crashing me into the rock. And after a little bit of time of going nowhere, I grabbed a hold of that rock, and I hoisted myself out. And as Hunter sat with me and I tried to compose myself, I'm like, thank you, buddy. Thank you for being here with me because I'm feeling so scared. And in that moment, safely on the rock, I would have just stayed there all day long, had a little picnic, enjoyed the sunshine, but there was no way to get back onto the land from that spot. So I had to get back in the water, trying to time my entry with a break in the crashing waves so that I could swim the 20 or so little feet to those big, beautiful rock stairs. I will tell you, my reentry was not graceful. A wave assisted me back into the water. And when that happened, I said to Hunter, "It looks like we're going now." And he just laughed because this is really nothing for him. And that precious young man swam behind me and made sure that I got where I needed to be. He did the same thing for his sisters, which was a beautiful thing to see. But later that night, when we were back at our house, I caught a glimpse of my right leg. And I saw a bruise pretty much the width of my leg across my knee. And the next day, when I saw both of my legs, I noticed they were covered in bruises of all different sizes, deep, purple reminders of hitting that rock over and over again. Something that I didn't feel the consequences of in the moment. I didn't even know it was happening. I was shocked that these were my legs. So it was hard really not to think about the verse that we just read, though, about Jesus either being the stone that we trip over or the stone that we build our life on. Because when we try and do life our way, spiritually, emotionally, even physically, we end up looking and feeling like my legs, like beaten and battered. But when we stand on the rock, when we stand on the truth of who God is, even though it won't always be easy, it won't always be fun, and it may not always feel good, he's going to hold us up. And that is Paul's motivation in what he's writing in these four verses. His heart is for the Jewish people. We have to remind ourselves of who Paul was. By his own words, he was the ultimate Jew. No one could come close to his academic or his moral achievements. He was revered for that. His life revolved around that. It was his identity. And then he had a life-changing collision with the rock, Jesus. And he talks about that transformation in his own words in Acts chapter 9. And when that collision happened, his life was complete. He was made whole. Everything that he was striving for ended. And yet, instantly, he became among the most hated of Jews by the other Jews, something that we also read about in the book of Acts. But he shares here in verse 1 of chapter 10 that it is his heart's desire that the Israelites be saved, that the people who beat him and imprisoned him and ran him out of towns and left him for dead, that they would know Jesus Christ. They're his brethren. He shares a kinship with them. He understands them. He gets the way that they think and the way they act, what they believe. He gets their stumbling points. So regardless of how they view him, it is his desire that they have a correct view of Jesus. And that's what the gospel does. When you truly understand the message of the gospel, when you experience it with your life, it's going to change your heart. But it is also going to give you a heart for those who are lost, for those who do not know Christ in that same life-changing way. And just like it did for Paul, it is going to weigh on you when someone you love doesn't know Jesus. And it should weigh on our heart. It should change not only how we view them, but also how we live our life in relation to them. Not in an arrogant condemnation, but in a humble exhortation on their behalf. It is going to change your prayer life for them. It needs to change your prayer life for them. How you spend your time, how you spend your resources. And the reason why is because you know who you were before you found out who Christ was. You know firsthand the transformation of your heart, of your mind, of your spirit, and you are going to long for that. For those who don't have it, because that's what the love of Jesus inside of you does. And Paul loves Christ, and he wants his kingdom to grow, and that is the big picture of everything that Jesus came to accomplish. Therefore, that needs to be the big picture of everyone who follows after him as well. To see people set free from the bondage of sin and to experience what it means to be made right before God. To experience his righteousness as a gift rather than something that you're trying to earn, that you're working to earn, that you can never earn. Rather than striving for something that will never be realized through your human effort. When we remember, when we remind ourselves what it was to be lost, our perspective shifts from wanting people to be happy to wanting people to be holy. And we begin to pray on their behalf that God will do what only he can do in their life to draw him to them. Even if, and this is tough, but even if that makes them temporarily uncomfortable. Because we understand that life without Christ is like treading water, but never reaching the shore. It is exhausting. It is without hope. And eventually, it's going to cause us to sink, right? Satan is the father of lies. He is the great deceiver. And his motivation is rooted in his hatred for God. So he will use whatever measure necessary to distract us from God, whether that's big, whether that's little, whether that feels good or whether it really doesn't, whether it lasts a moment or a lifetime, it doesn't matter. As long as your eyes are off of the Lord, and the longer you have your eyes off of God, the easier it is for him to keep your focus. And I've said it before, but it is so true, and this reality has impacted my life on such a deep level, but Satan is just a player. And he plays us with the hopes of hurting God. He doesn't love us. He's using us. Therefore, anything in our life that is not rooted in Christ is rooted someplace else. And we need to be reminded of this. We need to be willing to look at our lives and to be intentional to ask God to show us what needs to go. What is weighing me down? What is leading me away from you? And therefore, what is leading me away from the abundant life that you have for me, the abundant peace that you have for me? Because only Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Only Jesus. And as we have seen, as we've studied through Romans, the truth can hurt sometimes. The truth can make you feel things you'd rather not feel. The truth can prick your heart when you'd rather just carry on as you are. The truth can make you hate the one sharing it. And that's where the Israelites were. Believing following the law was the only thing that they needed. And they weren't even doing that very well. We know this. Jesus upset their system. He upset their lives. And because they were so certain they were right, they were blinded to the truth of who he was. If you recall Paul's words from a few chapters back in Romans 2, he said, "Circumcision benefits you if you observe the law. But if you are a lawbreaker, your circumcision has become uncircumcision." Paul has worked painstakingly hard to show that no one is capable of keeping the law. So why would you risk your salvation on something you can't even do? So he continues in verse 26. "So if an uncircumcised man keeps the law's requirements, will not his uncircumcision be counted as circumcision?" Highlighting that the Gentiles have a place in the kingdom, we have a place in the kingdom. Verse 27, "A man who is physically uncircumcised but who keeps the law will judge you who are a lawbreaker in spite of having the letter of the law and circumcision. For a person is not a Jew who is one outwardly." And without getting into the fine details of circumcision, the only point I want to make here is that that process removes skin that has no feeling. God told Moses, this is what is to be done to show that you are a devoted people, but you can't be devoted enough to earn your salvation, and you can't be circumcised enough or moral enough or good enough. And he says, and true circumcision is not something visible in the flesh. It's only through Jesus going to the cross. On the contrary, a person who is a Jew, who is one inwardly, and circumcision is of the heart, by the Spirit, not the letter. That person's praise is not from people, but from God. What's being said in these verses is God wants your heart circumcised. He wants the dead parts, the parts of your heart that have no feeling, to be removed, because it is all about our heart. Does God have full access to your heart? Not your religion, your heart. He wants a relationship with you. Because circumcision without faith couldn't save the Jewish person, just like baptism without faith can't save the Gentile, or going to church without faith, or doing anything, no matter how great it seems, without faith in Jesus, it doesn't save you. So you need to think, what is your faith in? Is it in your award-winning personality that you use to charm your way through life? Is it in your abilities? Is it in your morality? Is it in your finances? The fact that maybe based on what other people are like, you view yourself as somewhat better, and that's just enough to scooch you in? If your faith is not in Jesus Christ, it's not saving faith. So Romans 10:2, he said, "For I can testify about them that they are zealous for God, but their zeal is not based on knowledge." Only Paul could write these words. Only Paul, because he understood the Jewish person on such a deep level. He's like, they're zealous for God. They read the scriptures faithfully. They know the scriptures by heart. They live their lives by a strict code, and their morality is off the charts. And yet Paul is saying the desire of his heart is that people with all of those qualifications, that they be saved. If we were to put Paul's words into today's context, the people that he is describing could be faithful churchgoers, people who are eloquent prayers, people who tithe and try to live a good life. They are zealous, they are passionate, but for a God they don't know personally. And Paul knows this because he used to be this before he knew who Christ was. Have you ever noticed that the qualities in other people that you can find the most challenging tend to be found in you too? That is a really stinky reality. When you're like, why does that drive me so nuts? And then God's like, have you looked at yourself? Paul recognizes these traits because he lived them arguably better than any of them. Consider Paul's words in Galatians 1. "You know what I was like when I followed the Jewish religion, how I went after the Christians mercilessly, hunting them down and doing my best to get rid of them all. I was one of the most religious Jews of my own age in the whole country and tried as hard as I possibly could to follow all the old traditional rules of my religion." Paul was so zealous for God, he was willing to kill followers of Jesus because he saw them as heretics. He was there when Stephen was stoned. He approved of the stoning of Stephen. He was so zealous that murder was an okay solution, despite the fact that one of the laws of Moses says, hey, don't murder. Paul had zeal without faith. So consider his words in Philippians 3. "For it is we who are the circumcision, we who serve God by his Spirit, who boast in Christ Jesus, and who put no confidence in the flesh. Though I myself have reasons for such confidence, if someone else thinks they have reasons to put confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, in regard to the law, a Pharisee. As for zeal, persecuting the church. As for righteousness, based on the law, faultless." Paul is saying, I did it all. I checked every box, and I did it better than any of you. And yet he's saying, I needed to be saved. The last section of verses we're going to look at in regard to Paul personally is found in Acts 22. He said, "I am a Jew, born in Tarsus of Cilicia, but brought up in this city. I studied under Gamaliel and was thoroughly trained in the law of our ancestors. I was just as zealous for God as any of you are today. I persecuted the followers of this way to their death, arresting both men and women and throwing them into prison. As the high priest and all the council can testify, I even obtained letters from them to their associates in Damascus, and I went there to bring these people as prisoners to Jerusalem to be punished." Paul was crushing it with his resume of success as a Pharisee, and yet he needed to be saved. Zeal isn't enough. Following rules and traditions are not enough. You can do all the things. You can look the part. You can give your money. But if you do not know the Lord Jesus on a personal level, if you have not submitted your will for his, all the zeal, all the passion is worthless. This is what Jesus said in John 5. He was talking to the Pharisees. He said, "The Father who sent me has himself testified about me. You have not heard his voice at any time, and you have not seen his form. You don't have his word residing in you because you don't believe the one he sent. You pore over the scriptures because you think you have eternal life in them, and yet they testify about me. But you are not willing to come to me so that you may have life." We all grew up differently, right? Some of us grew up in the church. Some of us did not. We have all come to this moment in time via our own road, and I am so thankful that we are here together. But us being in this place does not save us. I grew up in the church. My grandpa on one side was a pastor. My grandma on the other side was the Energizer Bunny evangelizer. My parents served in pretty much every area of the church possible. I was in church week after week. I went to youth group and I went to summer camp. And don't get me wrong, all of those things were amazing blessings in my life. They were transformational things in my life, but not one of those things saved me. Only my decision to receive the gift offered to me by Jesus am I saved. Are you saved? So Romans 10:3 says, "Since they did not know the righteousness of God and sought to establish their own, they did not submit to God's righteousness." Paul is saying if they knew Jesus personally, that would be evident in their life. They wouldn't continue to live out what they think makes them righteous, what they think makes them better than other people. They would submit to what God says makes them righteous, and there would be a ridiculous amount of humility in the way that they lived their life. Our self-righteousness, and we're not going to kid ourselves and act like none of us in the room have it, our self-righteousness is rooted in something universal in all of us. You know, and in the world today, pride has taken on a variety of different meanings, but yet the original sin was pride, believing that we could know more than God, that we have the right to know more than God. And yet, that same thing, pride, is connected to the sin that we don't want to repent of, to the ways of living that we know we keep us from God, that we would rather hold on to those things because they make us feel better than we think that God ever could. And some of us will never come to Jesus because of the same thing, because of pride. I'm doing just fine on my own. Thank you very much. In the world today, when something is free, we tend to think it's cheap. We even say things like, "Nothing good in life is free," right? Therefore, as a result, our pride can make us think that what Jesus came to offer, well, it must not be all that great. A better version can be found somewhere else, and we search, and we try and find it. And when we hear words like, "You can't do it on your own," "You can't save yourself," watch out. That is next level when you're thinking from a prideful perspective. You might think something like, "Tell me I can't do that, and I'll show you 10 ways that I can." That's pride, right? So if other religious beliefs or if society or the world tells you that you can do this or you can do that, or you can work your way up the ladder, well, that gives you a chance to prove yourself. It gives you an opportunity to shine. But here's the deal. All right, I love basketball. So consider for a moment the game of basketball. You've got two players, and they each have a chance to take the game-winning shot. The first player takes the ball, shoots the ball, and misses the hoop completely. And without fail, everyone in the crowd yells what? Air ball, right? It's this visible failure at scoring. Whenever I watch the NBA, I'm like, oh my gosh, it was an air ball. Because you can't believe that people that good, that are paid that much, still shoot air balls. But that's okay. An air ball, though, is a visible failure at scoring. So there's 2 seconds left on the clock. The next player gets the ball, and they shoot the ball. The ball makes it into the hoop, and it swirls around the rim a few times, and you're holding your breath, wondering if it's going to go in, but it never actually drops through the net. Which of those players shot the better shot? Neither. One may have looked better than the other. One may have even given more hope, temporarily, than the other. But in basketball, there is a requirement for scoring, and that requirement says the ball must go through the net. So both players missed. We shoot shots in life all the time trying to score. Maybe we shoot shots trying to find success or to prove our worth or to feel good for a season. Maybe we want to hear the crowd roar over our success. But where we find true success, where we find Jesus, is on the sideline. He's the water guy. He's squirting water in our mouths. He's offering us rest. He's offering us peace. He's providing us with living water. But some of us will barely look at him because we think what will bring us joy and peace and purpose is found out there, on the field, rather than in here, in our heart. See, the greatest W of your life, the greatest win of your life, is found when you humble yourself and when you acknowledge that you are thirsty. It's found when you stop striving and when you come to the end of yourself. And the thief on the cross, he is a perfect example of that. Talk about the end. Talk about being stripped of everything, especially your pride, hanging virtually naked on a cross with what you did to get you on that cross laid out in front of you for everyone to see. And he's hanging next to Jesus. And in the final moments of his life, he asks Jesus to just remember him. Remember me. And Jesus says, I will do more than that. Today, you will be with me in paradise. Romans 10:4, for Christ is the end of the law, for righteousness to everyone who believes. See, the Jewish people were looking for a political deliverer. Jesus was not what they expected. Therefore, he was not what they wanted. But they're God's chosen people, and that matters an awful lot for them and for us. And we will see that in greater detail as we continue over the next few weeks. God loves and is not done with his people. But the fulfillment of the law is Jesus. He says, my salvation is here, and it is for everyone. I am extending it to you, but you have to be willing to receive it. See, Jesus, he's not an add-on. He isn't an addition to what you already have in your list of things that you value. Jesus desires and Jesus needs to be number one on a list that only has one name, Jesus. Psalm 23 says, the Lord is my shepherd. In him, I have what I need. There's nothing that the world can offer you that Jesus hasn't already provided for you. In Jesus, you have rest. Jesus gives you peace. He restores you. He directs your steps. If you don't know what to do, go to him. Ask him to make his will clear. Even in hard times, it says in Psalm 23, his rod and his staff comfort you. A shepherd's rod was used to beat off the enemy, and the staff was used to guide the sheep so that we can trust that everything that we go through, our good shepherd is leading us. And just envision this. He's leading you with power in one hand and grace in the other. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. He is not robbing you of what you think brings you joy. He is giving you the best joy there is. And when you know that, when you experience that in your life, you are going to want that for everyone else. And believer, I am talking specifically to you right now. You are not here to achieve success through a career path or being the best at X, Y, or Z, whatever that is. You are here to spread the truth of the gospel message of Jesus Christ. And God most certainly will use your career and the things that he's gifted you to do if you allow him to, but your identity, your purpose is so much greater than what you do. And prayer is your biggest weapon. It is your greatest tool. Pray relentlessly for those who do not yet know Jesus. That is what we are here for. In a relationship with Jesus Christ, nothing else. And that makes life awfully simple when you think about it. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, each of us in this room today could probably list 100 names of people that we know, people that we cross paths with, that do not know you as their Savior. And there are different reasons for each person why they are not coming to you. Maybe it's just simply they don't know. And Lord, we want to be effective in doing your will. We want to be humble in doing your will. We want to be full of your love. And so, God, I just pray as we go throughout this week, as we cross paths with people, as our kids go back to school in just, 7 days, that you would empower them, that we would know that you have given us the greatest gift, and that we would be obedient, that we would be willing to use our time and our resources to just speak the truth of who you are. We don't save people. You save people. But we want to be something that makes you attractive. And we want to do that well for your glory. And as we come to the communion table this morning, Lord, as we reflect on what you did to make our eternity secure with you in sending your son, Jesus, as we reflect on the fact that he died for our sins, that he rose on the third day, we thank you for the blood that was shed, for his body that was broken, for the restoration that that provides. Lord, you are so good. And I don't think we even have a glimpse of how good you really are. But we are so thankful for what we do see. And I just ask that you would reveal yourself to us as individuals. You know us so intimately. But that you would reveal yourself to us in ways that we can only pause and say, that was God. That was God. There is no question. Speak to us clearly. May we see what we need to see and know what we need to know for your glory. And we pray all of this in Jesus' name. If you have committed your life to Jesus, Doc and Mike are going to be administering the elements. Please feel free to come forward and receive communion. If you would like to be prayed over, Tony and I will be standing off to the side. We would love to pray with you. And if you would just like a blessing, just put your hand up. And we can do that as well. Thank you guys for being here with us. Just receive this blessing as you go, that the peace of God would fill you, that the righteousness of God would sustain you, and that his power would propel you forward to do what he calls you to do this week. We love you all. We'll see you soon. And there's cake.